Greetings again today in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Now it's good to see you here in the house of the Lord today. We appreciate your presence. We welcome the visitors that's visiting with us today. Always glad to have you visiting with us at Northside. Always good to see our members. So we appreciate your presence today. And to you that's listening out in the radio listen audience, we most certainly appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour that's coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens, Georgia. Now, this is Preacher Edward speaking. We're hoping during the next hour we can be an inspiration to you. And if you'll call a friend, you in the radio listen audience, if you'll call a friend, have them to tune in and get the hour coming up, I believe we can be a blessing to them. Maybe you know a shut-in that would get a blessing out of the singing and the preaching of God's Word. And so if you'll call, you'll be doing them a favor, and we appreciate it. Now take your Bible and turn, will you please, to Ephesians chapter 4. While you're turning to Ephesians chapter 4, I want the people here in the church to bear with me when I make mention of our proposed Holy Land tour to the Holy Land, because I do this for the benefit of the radio listening audience primarily. And I know our members, they hear me make mention of it so much, but they understand and they're considerate and hope it won't be boresome, but bear with me because there are probably people listening in the radio listed audience, maybe for the first time, or someone that's concerned about maybe going with us to the Holy Land in March of next year. We do have our brochures, of course, available. And then this is one of the greatest trips we've planned thus far because of two places in particular we plan to go. And we don't usually go to both of these places on one trip. We plan to go to Masada. Now, Masada is the place where the Jews held out 70 AD for some couple of years. Rather than be captured by the Roman legion, they committed suicide, more than 900 of them. And I've been there several times, and that's well worth the tour. And then we go to Petra, and Petra is a rose rock city. It's the color of a beautiful rose on the inside. It's a city hewed out in rock. And it's a beautiful city, and you go in on horseback. And it's I'll tell you, that's worth your trip alone, just to go to Petra. And then, of course, we're going into Jordan, and Jordan over into Israel, and be visiting the wonderful historical places like the Garden Tomb in Mount Calvary, taking a ride on the Sea of Galilee, eating some of Simon Peter's fish. And, well, just it's just a wonderful, wonderful trip. And after we leave Israel, we go back over to Amman, Jordan, and go from there over to Athens, Greece. And we'll be touring Mars Hill, where Paul preached his famous Mars Hill sermon. And it's a trip of a lifetime. If a person had to borrow every dime to go, it'd be well worth it. Someone asked Dr. Harold Seitler some few years ago, said, "Dr. Seitler, I want to go to the Holy Land. I don't have the money. If I go, I'll have to borrow every penny. What would you advise me?" He said, "Borrow it. Borrow the money and go. You never regret it." People get up money for automobiles, homes, furniture, clothes, vacations, Christmas time, holidays. And this would be one of the greatest things you'd sacrifice a dime for, to make this trip with us to the Holy Land. And so you need to get in touch with me and let me send you a brochure. Now's the time to get your name on the list. Now's the time to plan to go, and you look forward to it. Close to the time comes, and shout about it and praise God and look forward to going. Now, I want to hear from you in the radio listeners pertaining to our radio program, pertaining to the Holy Land Tour. And this is my mailing address, Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia. 30603 is the zip code number. Now, today, I hope you have your Bible open at Ephesians, the book of Ephesians, chapter 4. I'm going to speak to you today on maybe an unusual subject. I'm speaking on the subject to hell and back. Now I'll give you scripture for what I've announced in the way of my subject to hell and back. And we begin reading with Ephesians chapter 4 and beginning with verse 8. Now that's page 1253 in the original Scofield Reference Bible. Verse 8, Ephesians 4. "Wherefore he saith, when he ascendeth up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Now that he ascended, and what is it but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? He that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things, and gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Now the Bible tells you here that a person went down into the lower parts of the earth and then he came out. Now who is that person that did that? It's none other than Jesus Christ, our Savior. When Jesus died on the cross, he descended down into the heart of the earth. And then he remained there for 72 hours. And after 72 hours, he came out of the heart of the earth. Now at that particular time, hell was down in the bowels of the earth, and so was paradise. That's right down in the heart of this earth. Hell is still there. A lot of these volcanoes that belch out the terrible heat and lava that you see on the news screens and so forth, that's just a little part of hell that's coming out of the earth. The deeper you go, the hotter it gets. And down in the heart of this earth is fire, flames of billows rolling fire down in the heart of the earth, and that's hell. That's where sinners go. Now down in the heart of this earth, back before Calvary, every person that died, both saved and unsaved, descended down into the heart of the earth. Jesus said to the thief on the cross, "Today shall thou be with me in paradise." And down in the heart of the earth, they went down into paradise. And there were two compartments down there. One was called hell, and the other was called Abraham's bosom, or called paradise, right down into the bowels of this earth. But that's been changed now. Hell is still there, like always, like in Old Testament days, but paradise has been transferred out of the heart of the earth up into the third heaven. Now Paul was caught up into paradise. Let us know without a doubt that paradise had been changed from down in the earth up to the third heaven. And now when people die, instead of going down into paradise in the heart of the earth, in Abraham's bosom, they go up into the third heaven, and there in paradise they're waiting. Waiting for the resurrection when all the saints will be caught together. Now I want to mention my subject to hell and back, and I want you to notice first of all, one has been to hell and came back. Now Jesus went down into hell and he came back, and he entered the body, and he came out of the grave, and then for 40 days and nights he was seen upon the earth after he had gone to hell and back. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 27 and verse 46, about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice saying, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," that is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" God turned his back on Jesus as he was made sin for us. And then when he died, he went down into the heart of the earth, into paradise, and also crossed over into the other apartment and preached his spirits in prison. The Bible plainly tells you in Matthew chapter 12 and verse 40, as Jonah was in the belly of the whale 3 days and three nights, so was Jesus in the heart of the earth 3 days and three nights. Jonah was in the belly of the whale 72 hours. Jesus Christ was in the heart of the earth 72 hours. He was down there in paradise. He was also down there in hell, as the Bible tells us. Now in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 18 through 20, the Bible said there that Jesus preached and told them, "I'm the one that you were told about that would come and die on the cross, pay the sin debt." And you wouldn't believe Noah. You wouldn't believe what the preacher preached in his day. Therefore you drowned. Therefore you're down here in prison. And those spirits of the people of the days of Noah went right down into the heart of the earth. They died in unbelief. They failed to believe Noah as he preached. He was a preacher of righteousness. They failed to believe Enoch. They failed to believe anyone that preached in those days. They died and went to hell. And when Jesus died on the cross, he went down into hell and he told them, he said, "I'm the one that they told you about and you didn't believe it. And you did not believe Noah. You would not get saved. And you died and now you're in this place. I'm just letting you know that it's fulfilled what they said would happen." He didn't give them a chance to get saved. There's no such thing as a chance after death. There's no such thing as purgatory. That's a lie of the devil. If anybody talks about purgatory and a second chance after death, they're telling you lies, and that's a lie of the devil. Don't you believe a word of it. After a person dies and goes to hell, that's final. You can never be saved after you draw your last breath and leave your body. If you die unsaved, to hell you will go. If you die saved, to heaven you will go, according to the Bible. Now, Jesus went to hell and came back. In Acts chapter 2, verses 26 and 27, says, therefore did my heart rejoice and my tongue was glad. Move also my flesh to rest in hope, because thou wilt not leave my soul in hell. Neither will thou corrupt thy Holy One to see corruption. Now, what is he talking about there? He's quoting the Psalms, and the Psalms had to do with Jesus. And it says there that God would not leave Jesus in hell. Now, Jesus went down into hell, but he was not left there. He only stayed there 72 hours. He went there with a thief that got saved by his side on the cross. He said to him, today shall I be with me in paradise. And they both went straight down into paradise, right down in the bowels of this earth. But Jesus said, my soul won't be left there, and my body will not see corruption. At the time that Jesus was down in paradise, his body was in the grave, and it did not see corruption. His body was just as pure when he came back and entered that body as it did when he came out. Because he had a perfect body, no sin in it. Now, sin causes corruption in the body. And so there was no corruption in the body of Christ because he had a perfect body. So when he left paradise, he came straight back up to the body, entered the body, came out of the grave, and was seen on the earth 40 days and 40 nights. Therefore, his soul was not left in hell. Now, the psalmist predicted that. He's quoted in Acts chapter 2, that his soul would not be left in hell, and it was not. And so we see Jesus went to hell and came back. He did not go to hell to be punished, anything of that type, because he never did anything wrong. He went down there for a purpose of witnessing, and that he did. Now let's go to thought number two, and that is, one has been to hell and wanted to come back. The Bible tells us about one that went there and wanted to come back, but he didn't get a chance to do so. In Luke chapter 16, verses 27 and 28, then he said, I pray thee therefore, Father, that thou wouldst send him to my father's house, for I have five brethren, that he may testify them, lest they also come into this place of torment. So we find the rich man died and went to hell. He wanted to come back, but he couldn't. He wanted Lazarus to come back and warn his brothers, but he could not. And so he was caught in hell, never to be able to get out of there until the judgment. And then he's going out to be sentenced to the lake of fire. Now, he went to hell and wanted to come back. And every inmate in hell today would give anything if they could just get out of that place and have one more chance to get saved. They're screaming, they're crying, they're begging, they're praying, they're pleading. They're in hell today, and they saying, what a fool I was. I thought I could live in sin and live without God and get saved just before I died and go to heaven. But they died unexpectedly. They died without God. Some died in unbelief and fell down into hell. Never a chance to get out. Every soul that's ever gone to hell is going to stay there till the judgment. Now, if God should let one inmate in hell out, everyone in hell that raise a finger against God and say, you're not just God, you let one out and you didn't let the others out. So God therefore will not let one soul out of hell. In prison today, you have men sent to prison and they have some hope, even some sent there, sentenced to never be able to get out. That was a sentence that could never be released, but they still have some hope. They hope that they'll escape someday. They hope that maybe that'll be changed and they'll have a chance to get out. And they can come back out of the prison and live again on the earth on the outside. They have that hope. But people in hell don't have that hope. They can never get out of that terrible place. They'll be there forever. They'll be transferred from there. We'll tell you about that later. But they'll only be transferred to be brought before God to be judged and sent to the lake of fire. Now, we don't have any judicial system in America today. It stinks to high heaven and make a buzzard vomit. Now, I guess the other day I was reading where they tried a man up here in the north or northeast. He killed 13 people, committed cold-blooded murder, robbed and killed 13 people, and they sentenced him to life in prison. Now, some of the loved ones, the victims that died, began to scream and say, he ought to be put to death, he ought to be put to death. But the crooked judges and the jury, they had no backbone, only sentenced him to life. So the victims of the poor man that killed their loved ones will have to pay for his time in prison now, which will cost better than $20,000 a year, maybe for the rest of his life, unless he kills somebody else that gets killed or escape. And they'll have to foot the bill. They've already suffered the loss of their loved ones. Now they're going to have to pay the bill for that criminal that killed 13 people, innocent people, in a robbery. Now that stinks. That's pitiful. That'll make a buzzard vomit. Another man here in Georgia, the state is execution after it had been reviewed some 15 or 16 times. Some of these crooked lawyers and judges and ACLU crowd and some of the rest of them have run their long noses over that record some 15 or 16 times and appealed and stayed the execution and been doing that for 8 years. And so they're still having to feed and clothe them and take care of them because our rotten, stinking, filthy, crooked judicial system in the United States of America don't have the guts to put a man to death when he's sentenced to die by a jury. Now, God's going to deal with some of these appeal lawyers and some of these courts and some of these judges and some of these crooks that stay these executions. And then the taxpayer will have to pay tax money to feed those cold-blooded murderers while they're in prison or while they're on death row, when the Word of God plainly teaches capital punishment. And the Word of God said, if a man maliciously takes another man's life, his punishment is death. He's to be put to death. Now, some of these mealy-mouthed liberals today, they don't have sense enough to get in out of the rain or say, well, we know that capital punishment and the death penalty does not deter crime. That a man has to be stupid to believe something like that. Beloved, we know it does deter crime because when you put a man in it, he can't kill anybody else. And there's been hundreds and hundreds killed by people after they had been sentenced and put in prison and let out and killed somebody in prison. And so it stinks. Until we can get some politicians today that'll do something about it, the poor, innocent, law-abiding citizen in Georgia and here in the United States of America is going to have to suffer. They're going to have their loved ones killed and murdered. They're going to have to pay the bills for these criminals until we get some politicians and some judges that's got backbone and wisdom enough and sense enough to know what to do and what they should do and not bow down to these liberals and infidels and atheists and go-devils and modernists and all that other crowd. You may say, preachers, I don't like it. I don't care if you don't. God didn't tell me to preach what you like. He told me to preach what I believe and what I'm convicted of, what this book tells us about. And the book certainly teaches capital punishment, whether you like it or not. God said it, and if you want to argue about it, argue with God. The Bible said, let God be true and every man a liar. And so we must believe the book. But when this man wanted to come back from hell, but he couldn't. Number three, no one else will ever go to hell and come back. No one else will ever go to hell and come back. The Bible says in Luke chapter 16 and verse 26, and beside all this, between you, us and you, there's a great gulf fixed. So they was a passive history, you cannot, neither can they pass us that would come from thence. So the Bible tells us there that no one will ever go to hell and come back. Jesus Christ is the only one that ever went there and came back, and nobody else will ever do it. Never. Now let's find out number four what hell is. Number one, hell is a place of darkness. Hell is a place of darkness. Darkness is an awful thing. There's something about darkness sometimes, especially when you're afraid, that you dislike. Darkness is bad when you're afraid. That's what I'm trying to say. It's not an awful thing unless you're afraid. In Matthew chapter 22, verses 12 and 13, and he said unto him, friend, how camest thou in hither not having a wedding garment? And he was speechless. Then said the king of the servants, bind him hand and foot and take him away and cast him into outer darkness. Thou shalt be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Hell is a place of outer darkness. Down there they have darkness. Down there they're in flames. Down there it's an awful place to be among the screaming inmates of this terrible place, a place of weeping. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 22 and verse 13, thou shalt be weeping. Thou shalt be gnashing of teeth. People wailing, people mourning, people praying, but they're praying too late. Hell is a madhouse this morning. Hell is a place of conscience. No doubt about that. People are alive there. These no-hellites that say that the soul sleeps and there's no such thing as hell forever or just a bonfire. It's all over. They're preaching and teaching lies. Don't you believe a word of it. You have cults in the land today that teach those lies. They teach soul sleep. They teach that hell is a bonfire and then all over. And you never know anything else. Don't you believe the lies of the devil? Some of these no hellites are trampling around now. There's some of these backslidden Baptists that ought to be in church trying to leave the literature in their door, in their house, get their foot in the door to try to give them a little teaching on that so-called Bible course. Beloved, they're doing that because they're teaching lies, and Satan is encouraging them to do so. And the backslidden Baptists wouldn't be at home to accept it if it'd be in the house of God where they ought to be. Now it said here, if thy hand offend thee, cut it off. It's better for thee to enter into life maimed than having two hands to go into hell. Who said that? Jesus. Into the fire that never shall be quenched, where the worm doth not and the fire is not quenched. If thy foot offend thee, cut it off. It's better for thee to enter halt into life than having 2 feet to be cast into hell in the fire that never shall be quenched. While the worm doth not, the fire is not quenched. If the eye offend thee, pluck it out. It's better for thee to enter into the kingdom of God with one eye than having 2 eyes to be cast into hell fire. While the worm doth not, and the fire is not quenched. Now, beloved, in hell they're alive. In hell they're conscious. In hell they have their hands, their feet, their eyes. They have their soulless bodies tormented in hell down there today, screaming in the regions of the damned. Hell is a place of separation. In Luke chapter 16 and verse 26, beside all this, between us and you, there's a great gulf fixed. So they which would pass from hence, you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from thence. There's no such thing as getting over from paradise into hell or from hell into paradise. There's no such thing as having a visit in hell from some loved one, a friend, or a minister to try to help you. When you go to hell, you're separated forever away from God's people, away from God. And you're cast in among the scum of the earth that live among the wicked, the Adolf Hitlers and Joe Stalins and all of that crowd in the flames of burning hell and the drunks and the murderers and all of that crowd. It's awful, a terrible place to dwell with that crowd, and that's exactly where you'll go if you die without God. Hell is a place of fire. In Matthew chapter 25 and verse 41, then shall he say also unto them on the left hand, depart from me, you cursed, into everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. Everlasting fire. The Bible says in Mark chapter 9 and verse 43, then having 2 hands to go into hell in the fire that never shall be quenched. Hell is everlasting fire that never shall be quenched. Hell is a place of constant lust. In Revelation chapter 22 and verse 11, he that is unjust, let him be unjust still. He which is filthy, let him be filthy still. He that is righteous, let him be righteous still. He that is holy, let him be holy still. Now, hell is a place of filth. Hell is a place where God dumps all the filth of humanity from the universe into this terrible place. That's why they go there without God. Hell is a place of insanity. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes chapter 9 and verse 3, the hearts of the sons of men are full of evil, and madness is in their heart while they live and after they go to the dead. Hell is a place of madness. There are sons down there fighting their fathers, pointing their fingers at their fathers and mothers, saying if you'd have lived for God, if you hadn't been so worldly and ungodly, and if you hadn't been an infidel and atheist, I might have got saved. I wouldn't have followed you into hell. I want you to know I hate you. I hate you. There's children pointing their fingers at their fathers, those that died without God. I'm talking about children above the age of accountability. There's brothers pointing their fingers at brothers and daughters against mothers. There's multitudes pointing their fingers in hell at old apostate priests and rabbis and preachers that are apostates that know not God and died and went to hell. There's mobs of people down there pointing their fingers at them and saying, you supposed to have been a priest, you supposed to have been a minister, you supposed to have been a preacher, and you let us die and go to hell, and you didn't tell us the truth. You are liberal, you're modernist, you're infidel, and you led us to hell. We're going to hate you and hate you forever. I'd hate to go to hell after deceiving people down there and have them point at me and say, well, if you'd have told them the truth, I wouldn't have been here. Hell is a place of insanity. It's a crazy house. Have you ever been to insane asylum where people are raving and butting their heads in the walls and cursing and carrying on? Hell is a place like that. It's a madhouse. It's a crazy house. It's a place filled with cursing. And people are carrying on in a manner down there that almost drive you crazy if you were not already crazy when you get there. It's an awful place. Hell is a place where sinners are thrown to. The Bible tells us in Revelation chapter 20 and verse 15, whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. That's coming a time at the end of the millennium when God's going to say to the bowels of this earth, all sinners from wicked Cain, right on to the end of the millennium, come up out of hell. Every lost sinner that died from wicked Cain right on to the end of the millennium is going to come out of hell. They're all going to stand before God. God will open up the books, and God will judge them according to their wickedness upon the earth. If they have been very much wicked, their punishment will be greater. See, there's degrees of punishment in the lake of fire. And so when God judges them, there stands a good moral mother. She was good and kind and lived clean and honest and went to church and good to her family, yet she didn't get saved. She died and went to hell. There stands old Joe Stalin, Adolf Hitler, that killed millions and millions of innocent people. Old Hitler responsible for 40 million deaths. He's going to stand before God, and he died and went to hell. They'll stand before God. God's going to sentence them to the lake of fire. Do you think that good moral mother that minded her business, that was not evil on the earth in the way of living a terrible wicked life, when she's sentenced to the judgment bar of God and cast in the lake of fire, you think she's going to be punished as much as Hitler? No, sir. No, sir. There's degrees of punishment in hell. That has nothing to do with the time element. Hell is forever. But there will be degrees of punishment. You can go to the penitentiary today, you can find trustees. They're there, and they'll be there for length of time as long as some of the others. But some of them are kept in places where they cannot get out and cannot get with others because they're so weak and evil. Some maybe work harder than others. The trustees have it easier because of the type of crime they committed and because of their conduct while there. In hell, there's degrees of punishment. The more wicked you are, the harder, the worse you're going to be punished when you die and stand before God at the great white throne judgment. At the great white throne judgment, God is going to pass his sentence out on all people that died without God. From the beginning, from Cain, right on the end of the millennium, God is going to pass out their sentence. And then God is going to say, cast them into the lake of fire. And every last one of them will be cast into the lake of fire. Now, some believe that the lake of fire will be the sun. The sun is a tremendous ball of fire. It's tremendous. The sun is so many million miles away. If it should come any closer in the last 2 or 3 weeks, it would have burned up. But God set it out there in its place and let the earth revolve around like he wanted to. But the sun is an awful hot place. And many people believe that is the lake of fire. And all of these sinners will be cast into that lake of fire in the billows of flame, where they'll be tormented forever and forever and forever. Can you afford to go on without God? Can you afford to take a chance on dying without Jesus? Can you go on and say, well, someday I'll get saved? There's millions in hell right now that fully intended to have gotten saved, but they died suddenly, killed in an accident, maybe died of a heart attack, had a stroke, maybe died in a fight or something happened, and they went out in eternity without getting saved. And you have no excuse. You may say, now, Preach Edwards, I think God would be too good to let me go to hell. You'll find out if you die without Jesus Christ. God is not going to take anybody to heaven that dies unsaved. I don't care who they are. You may feel like you're the best person living. You'll go to hell if you die without Jesus. I don't care who you are. God cannot go back on his word. And anybody that dies unsaved goes to this terrible place called hell. People that die in the faith go to paradise yonder in the third heaven. Now that's up to you. God is not going to force you to get saved. God will never do that. God provided you a way of salvation. God gave his son, and he died on the cross for you, shed his blood. Now God said, if you want to be saved, you can. If you want to escape hell, you can. If you will go to heaven, you can. But if you don't want to, and you love the world, and you'd rather go on and gamble, and you go to hell, you blame nobody but yourself. And that's true. If you die and go to hell, you blame nobody but yourself. And if you don't know that you're saved today, I advise you to get saved, because you don't know when that heart will stop beating, when you'll be snatched out in eternity. Hell is an awful place. And if you're not ready to meet God, it'd pay you to get ready and take no more chances. God's been good. He's let you live this long without letting you go to hell. And you need to get right with God. Now I want you to take heed to what I say. And you in the radio listening audience, some of you ought to get on your knees before your radio there and ask God to save you. Repent and ask God to save you before you end up in the terrible place called hell. I beg you to do so. You ought to do it before it's too late. I trust you will. Everybody stand on your feet, would you please? Our Father, I pray today that you'll take the message and that you'll use it to thy glory. Lord, hell's an awful place. We know, our Father, that people that die without Jesus go there. You don't want anybody to go there, Lord. Hell's prepared for the devil and his angels, but people go there because they fail to get saved. And I pray that somebody in the radio listening audience, maybe even in this auditorium, would get saved today. Have you in this invitation, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us stand, and John's going to play a couple stanzas on the organ. And as she plays, if you need to get saved, come back to God, join the church. If God is speaking to you to come forward for any reason, I want you to come while we wait. Would you come? If God is speaking, would you come? I've given you the message, God, laid on my heart. It's up to you now.